Welcome back and the final symposium, Know Your Heartbeat. We'll be starting the first presentation, that's practical approach to acute coronary syndrome. Again, very interesting, very important topic. Will be conducted by Dr. Sampath Vithanawasam, the consultant cardiologist of the National Hospital of Sri Lanka. Over to you, Dr. Sampath.
First and foremost, I would like to thank Sri Lanka Medical Association for giving us this valuable chance to discuss this important practical approaches about acute coronary syndrome with you. My intention today not to highlight all the management aspects of acute coronary syndrome, but just to highlight very important message, give to important message to you. As you are aware, worldwide number one killing disease is coronary artery disease, no difference in Sri Lanka. According to our data, 40% of deaths are due to coronary artery disease. Acute coronary syndrome, essentially a clinical diagnosis, that is a history made by a diagnosis made by history. Chest discomfort in the form of pain, pressure, tightness, or burn, or equivalent symptom, the cornerstone of this syndrome. The referred pain is a common thing when it comes to autonomic nervous system supplies to the heart. Because of the same reason, not only the chest that you feel discomfort, it may be anywhere below the your jawline and above the umbilical level, and the front of the chest and the back of the chest, including both arms. And in addition, the other chest pain equivalent are breathing difficulty and sometimes profuse sweating with nauseated feeling could be the sole symptom. Actually, that the typical chest pain that we expected to experience only experiences about 30% of the patients. And if this speech, if this symptoms comes with rest or with minimum exertion or new onset of symptoms of class 3 or 4 severity, worsening of symptoms in terms of severity, frequency, or not responding to your usual medication, or post-MI symptoms, probably you are dealing a patient with acute coronary syndrome. But having said that, 50% of acute chest pains present to emergency department are non-cardiac. So you should be very careful about non-cardiac situations also. This is the diagnostic algorithm for chest pain patient. It's straightforward. If a patient comes with the typical chest pain or equivalent symptoms that we have discussed with ST elevations, that patient comes to the category of ST elevation MI. But if the patient comes with the typical symptoms without ST elevation, then you need to go for troponins to further clarification. If your troponins are positive, then it comes to non-ST elevation MI category. And if your troponins are negative in the presence of typical symptoms, that is unstable angina. But you should be careful. There are some cardiac situations also that your troponins may be positive with some chest pain, but still non-coronary disease. For example, myocarditis, tachyarrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias, Takotsubo syndrome are some of them. Even aortic dissection, pulmonary embolism can cause in a similar way, but not a coronary disease. So the all the other things where you get a localized non-cardiac type of chest pain with non-specific ECG changes with troponin negativity, you can categorize to or rule out myocardial infarction or unstable angina. This is universal definition of myocardial infarction. The essential thing is the troponin rise. With the troponin rise, if you have one of these things, symptoms of myocardial ischemia or new ischemic ECG changes or development of pathological Q waves in the ECG or imaging evidence or intracoronary thrombus in angiography or autopsy, that confirm myocardial infarction. We'll quickly go through pathophysiology. There are a lot of researchers on the pathophysiology. We thought for decades that only the atherosclerotic plaque and the vulnerable plaque causing acute coronary syndrome. But there are evidence coming on that non-atherosclerotic situations also can cause acute coronary syndrome. The commonest is the inflammatory plaque that rupture with the fissure, which causes blood clot in the artery. With the increasing inflammatory markers and the macrophage close to the clot, that is the commonest pathology. But there are other situations. Actually, the four distinct pathways has been identified. The other pathway is the Fischer's plaque, but without inflammation. Third thing is the endothelial erosion without fissuring of the plaque. And fourthly, the without thrombus, that you may get myocardial infarction due to epicardial vessel spasm or even microvasculature spasm. STEMI is straightforward diagnosis. If your history is clear with the ST elevation MI and ST elevation MI, unless proven otherwise. But unfortunate fact that even this with classical history, with classical ECG changes, we tend to miss this and cause infertilities. STEMI ECG criteria. You all are aware, but just to highlight two facts, you need to know that whether these ST elevations are in two or more contiguous leads and whether these ST elevations are really significant. To see the significance in V2 to V3 leads, in a male less than 40 years, it should be 2.5, more than 2.5 millimeters, and less than 40 years, it's more than 2 millimeters, and in female, more than 1.5 millimeters. All other leads, except for posterior leads, it should be more than 1 millimeters. And in the posterior leads, it should be 0.5 millimeters to be call it as significant. And other confusing fact, when the chest pain comes with left bundle branch block. And as you know, when to get a left bundle branch block in an ischemic patient, the territory of ischemia should be quite large. And because of that, these patients are naturally more sicker than other usual ST elevation MI patient. So if a patient comes with hemodynamic compromise with left bundle branch block, regardless of whether it's new or old, I'm repeating, regardless of whether it's new or old, you should treat it as acute ST elevation MI. Having said that, if the LBB patient comes with chest pain and very hemodynamically stable, then you can buy some time to go for troponin before treating that type of patient. Sub-OSA criteria may be helpful to identify. I will quickly go through. As you know, in normal left bundle branch block pattern, the QRS complexes are mostly negative in V1 to V3 and most of the other leads is positive. What sub-OSA suggested, in concordant ST segment elevation more than 1 millimeter in leads with positive QRS complexes, or concordant ST depression more than 1 millimeter in V1 to V3 leads, or discordant ST segment elevation more than 5 millimeter in negative QRS complexes, that is suggestive of acute ischemia. STEMI pathophysiology is quite clear. Total or near total obstruction of the coronary. The treatment, straightforward, reperfusion or opening the artery. But what you should keep in mind, if you are going to open this artery, we should open before the muscle going to die. That is within very short timely period that we have to have. So that gives the total ischemic time, gives an idea which time for how much time that we have. This slide explains what is total ischemic time. So total ischemic time, the time from the onset of the pain to the time that we are opening the artery, either form of medical or mechanical thrombolysis. Unfortunately, in Sri Lanka, the most important thing that we need to tackle at the moment, patient delay and the transport delay, because we know most of the patients, when they think that they need to come to the hospital, it takes quite longer time, sometimes 2-3 hours without taking any medications and only taking anti-gastric treatment and some paracetamol. And the transport delay in our traffic congestion is quite significant. We should have dedicated ambulance service for that. And even after a patient comes to the hospital, that we currently experience significant delay until patient get the proper treatment, because our system is not adapted to cater ST elevation in my patient to giving this valuable time, that is to keep the total ischemic time in the proper range. So this is the reperfusion strategy selection, that if a patient comes to the PCI center, that patient should be go for primary PCI within next 60 minutes, ideally, to give the best results. But if the patient goes to a non-PCI center, then we have to decide whether we can transfer this patient to a PCI center within next 120 minutes. If possible, that is the best way of treating. But if you can't achieve that target, best thing is to thrombolyze within 30 minutes and then send the patient for tertiary center for coronary angiogram and PCI within next 24 hours, which is called pharmaco-invasive therapy, which is the best mode of treatment in Sri Lanka at present. Treatment, or otherwise reperfusion delay, is one of the best indicator of quality of care in STEMI management. There are a lot of practical models has been suggested to improve this ischemic total ischemic time. One of the system is suggested by Sri Lankan STEMI Forum, but none of the system has been properly adapted to current system at the moment, which we have to improve. Are we doing good at this moment in Sri Lanka? No, definitely not. We have quite a lot to improve ourselves and from the patient side and from the government side to improve infrastructure to deal a STEMI patient in a proper manner. So I quickly go through to acute coronary syndromes without persistent ST elevations. This is quite easy, that I have discussed with you previously. If no ST elevations in the ECG and troponin positive, is non-STEMI. If your troponins are negative in the presence of typical history, that is unstable angina. But you should be keep in mind, in unstable angina, your troponins are negative, your ECG may be normal, and if you are not vigilant about history, you can miss unstable angina. And keep in mind other non-cardiac causes also. Pharmacological treatment for non-STEMIs. There are a lot of armory that we have in our shelf to treat acute coronary syndrome. Antithrombotic drugs, statins, beta blockers, AC inhibitors, ARB blockers, anti-anginal agents, and etc. But I'm going to mainly deal antithrombotic drugs today. The antithrombotic drug should be individually tailored to get the proper antithrombotic intensity by way of its proper choice, proper combination, and the proper dose. Not only that, at which point that we are initiating antithrombotic medication and antithrombotic duration. These are important to maximize ischemic protection, to reduce further ischemic event, and also most importantly, to minimize bleeding risk. These are the few drugs that we have in our armory. Anticoagulant drugs and antiplatelet drugs. In combination, we call those category antithrombotic medication. Anticoagulant drugs. What we use mainly is unfractionated heparin or enoxaparin, fractionated heparin, but you can use bivalirudin in the proper setup, dabigratin in the proper setup, and other anticoagulants, vitamin K antagonists, and the novel oral anticoagulant agents, apixaban, edoxaban, and rivaroxaban. On the other side, antiplatelet drugs. Our main armor is aspirin, thromboxane A2 inhibitor. And the other main drug is P2Y12 inhibitors, that is ADP block receptor blockers, clopidogrel, prasugrel, ticagrelor, and cangrelor, IV agent, which is not available currently in Sri Lanka. And the glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors, apixaban, that we used profusely in our cath labs, and the tirofiban and epitafibide. As I told you, while you are treating a patient with ischemia, the other main side effect that experience is bleeding. So you have to counteract bleeding. For that, you have to have good idea about the risk of bleeding before treating a patient with ischemia. There are a lot of tools available and you can easily download it from the internet. You can get the ischemic risk correct by GRACE score, which is most validated at present. And the bleeding risk you can do by CRUSADE score or ARC-HBR risk score stratification. So you can get some idea about your patient's bleeding risk opposed to the ischemic risk, which can be useful to adjust the proper antithrombotic agent intensity and the duration. So a lot of regimes available for us. If a patient's bleeding risk is very low, then it's the easiest way. You have a lot of combination with us. The dual antiplatelet that we are usually practice for 1 year in the form of aspirin with prasugrel, aspirin with ticagrelor, or aspirin with clopidogrel. If a patient going for a PCI, best combination, if at all, aspirin with prasugrel. If not, the best combination, aspirin with ticagrelor. But if there is non-availability or economic reason, we can use aspirin and clopidogrel, which we are practicing in this country at the moment in most of the time. After 1 year, if the patient hasn't experienced a bleeding for last 1 year and the ischemic risk is high, better to continue dual antiplatelet further, either whatever the form, aspirin with ticagrelor, aspirin with prasugrel, or a clopidogrel. Or with the patient with, especially with peripheral vascular disease, aspirin with low dose rivaroxaban equally better or better. Other form in a low risk patient, aspirin with ticagrelor, dual antiplatelet for 3 months, and then thereafter single antiplatelet drug for long time, probably for life. And if a patient having a high bleeding risk, for that patient, aspirin and clopidogrel for 3 months, thereafter aspirin monotherapy. If the patient's bleeding risk very high, that is a patient who has had major bleeding within last month, or if a patient waiting for a postponable major surgery within next couple of months, those patients can be treated with aspirin and clopidogrel for first month, and thereafter clopidogrel monotherapy for long term, and timing of invasive coronary artery. If a patient comes to the PCI center and his ischemic risk is very high, ischemic very high risk is defined by hemodynamic instability, cardiogenic shock, recurrent chest pain despite medical treatment, life-threatening arrhythmias, mechanical complication, acute heart failure, or AVRS elevation. Those patients has to go to the cath lab within 2 hours. And other high-risk bleeding, high-risk ischemic patients, as defined by established non-STEMI diagnosis, dynamic ST-T wave changes, resuscitated cardiac arrest without ST segment elevation, or high-grade risk score more than 140. Those patients has to go to the cath lab within next 24 hours. Other patients are low-risk patients, and these patients can go for elective procedure or even other modality of investigation like CT coronary angiogram. I just want to highlight a couple of things which come up with the recent ESC guidelines. Now, we are usually giving dual antiplatelet loading once a patient comes with acute coronary syndrome, non-STEMI, before going them to cath lab. But recent guideline highlighted not to give P2Y12 inhibitor loading if your patient's coronary anatomy is not aware and if your patient going to the cath lab within next 24 hours. But if your patient is going to the cath lab after 24 hours or delayed PCI, then probably you can initiate dual antiplatelet drugs. By initiating dual antiplatelet drugs before knowing coronary anatomy, the main disadvantages, one thing is if the patient is going for bypass surgery, not suitable for PCI, then the surgeons will have problem. Bleeding risk may be more higher than the ischemic risk. And the other thing is unnecessary bleeding problems. And this is again, this as a practical point I wanted to highlight with regard to anticoagulant treatment. Now, as a usual practice, when you diagnose non-STEMI, that we give with aspirin, dual antiplatelet, as I told, and with that enoxaparin. But the recommendation, don't cross over unfractionated heparin and low molecular weight heparin. And if your patient is going for cath lab, don't give unfractionated heparin because in our cath lab, we are using don't give low molecular heparin because our cath labs using unfractionated heparin during the procedure. So it is easy that if you are loaded with unfractionated heparin and document the dose and the time, that we can top up at the cath lab very easily. And this is again another new thing that comes with if your patient in on anticoagulant drug, either form of vitamin K antagonist warfarin or any NOAC treatment. And if these patients are coming, if they are coming with non-STEMI and going to the cath lab, this message is important. If your patient is on warfarin or NOAC, do not discontinue those drugs. If the patient is on warfarin and if the patient's INR is more than 2.5, you can go for the procedure without administrating additional heparin for that patient. It is safe. And if your patient is on NOAC and don't discontinue it, send them with the same regular dosing and the cath lab staff can add on enoxaparin or anticoagulation irrespective of timing of the last dose. So that can be done safely. That is the safest practice at present. So with that remarks, I will conclude giving the opportunity for my colleagues to discuss and coming up with more interesting aspects of acute coronary syndrome. Over to you. Thank you very much.